going to do all the chapters in Revelation this morning. So I hope you brought your lunch and dinner and breakfast for tomorrow. Some of you aren't smiling. Before I speak, I want to just say we've sent out several surveys from the office, and we've got a lot of you responding to that. I want to say thank you, because you're helping us to make decisions to move forward. And thank you for your prayers, because this season that we're in is a strange season in that you can't make everybody happy. You make some people happy and some people mad, some people mad, some people happy. So you try to make the best decisions you can. And so thank you. Thank you for being here. Thank you for just loving Jesus. And I know there are many who would love to be here and can't. So our heart goes out to them. We have, as you know, the words rapid expansion have been spoken over Christian life on a couple of occasions, and from various people as well, not knowing each other even. And so we have taken that word to heart, and we have been praying and planning and asking God, so what if we were to expand rapidly? How many know rapid means rapid? How many know rapid means quick? Rapido. Andre. It's going to happen fast is the idea we get from that. So with that, we're asking God, what would you want us to do in preparation for that? We're so thankful that over the last several years, we've been able to put some systems in place in the church to help the church function healthily. Healthily, is that a word? Healthily, in health. And now we're looking at launching two services here at Christian Life. So what we plan on doing is maybe removing some of the seats that are in here. So especially those that would love to come that can't because they just don't feel like maybe we're doing enough social distancing, we'll be able to do that. But that's not the big reason. The big reason is rapid expansion. We're just trying to think of some of the positive things would happen from this. So we would have a 9 o'clock service. We would have an 11 o'clock service. And our big concern is, my big concern, and maybe some of yours, is where does our prayer service fit into that? So we are going to move our prayer service to 8 a.m., which is still not really early. Some of you get up earlier than that for work. I join a prayer service on Thursday mornings, and some of my brothers in California are getting up at 6 o'clock to pray with other brothers across the nation. So if my fellow friends can get up at 6 and pray, certainly we could be here for 8 o'clock. And we're thinking about moving our prayer service to the upstairs fellowship hall. It'll take on a little different probably atmosphere than we have here in the sanctuary, but we're going to just ask the Lord to continue to help us with that. Our children's church, at least to start with, will be offered during the first service, the 9 o'clock service. We had a majority of the people that responded to the survey said they would bring their children to the first service, because at 11 o'clock, then you're getting into 12 o'clock with naps and lunch and all of that, so things we probably wouldn't have thought of on our own. So we're taking steps of faith for this rapid expansion. We're creating more opportunities as well, as you can imagine. Now we have two services, so we're going to need people in our nurseries, in our teaching places, wherever, people greeting at the doors, wherever the areas are that we're needing help on Sunday morning. Some of you that aren't serving are going to have to step up and take some leadership in some of those areas. And so we hope that your gifts will be used there. As we're making this transition and decision, we're looking at the second week in September that we'll actually launch that. So what we really need right now is for you to be praying about that transition, and asking God to help you to know how to make that transition possible for all of us, what that means to you as a family, what that means to us as a church. One of the things that happens with two services, one of the obvious things is many of you won't get to see each other. You'll wonder if so-and-so is even going to church anymore. And so that's one of the things that we have to surrender to expand. When my waistline expands, I have to surrender another loop in my belt. And I got to just keep going further and further out. Hey, by the way, I noticed I'm going the opposite direction now. I went one more notch the other way. So maybe sometimes that happens in church as well. But we're expanding the loops in our belt, and so we're going to need all of our help. Would you join me in praying for that in the future? Would you, as you're thinking about that, instead of complaining or whatever feeling we might have about that, Lord, we want to just bless what you're doing. This is all about His kingdom, right? Let me. Was my microphone? This is all about His kingdom, right? That's right, my mic was on. It really is all about Him. And listen, let's not be Christians who get in the mode that church is for me. Church is all about Him. It's His kingdom. It's His kingdom. Amen? And so we just want to be good stewards of His kingdom. So, Lord, as we jump into your word now in the book of Revelation, we want to just thank you for the Holy Spirit who leads us and guides us into all truth. And I pray, as we're going to hear over and over and over again this morning, this phrase from the second and third chapter, "He that has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches." And Father, we are your church. We have ears, physical ears, but you're asking us to put on some spiritual discernment so that we can hear what you're saying to the churches and to this part of the church here, to us personally. Help us to make that application of your word to our hearts today, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. I was on one of my prayer walks, and I listened to scripture while I'm walking, and this passage in Revelation popped up, and this, he that overcomes, you'll see that as we're talking about the passage today, he that overcomes, I will, and God makes some promises for the overcomer. Do we have any overcomers in the house today? 12 of you, good. So this is for the rest of you. By the time we finish, I hope you become one of the 12 in the room. I want to just title this with a question: Are you an overcomer? And I hope that this kind of gets inside of our spirit and does something for us today. The Apostle John had many titles, the writer of the book of Revelation. One of his titles, he was one of the sons of thunder. If you remember James and John, the brothers, they kind of were rough guys, from I'm guessing. And it's very interesting when you see John being called into the ministry as a son of thunder, and then you find him as a disciple, and they call him John the Beloved. How many know sons of thunder and John the Beloved are kind of on opposite ends of the bookcase, right? And so his heart was being changed. So he's John the Beloved, he's John the Revelator, he's the disciple, he's an apostle. But he wrote the Gospel of John and three of the epistles, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, as we know them, and then this book of Revelation. And John was the head of the church in Ephesus. He was the pastor of the church in Ephesus, where it is thought that he wrote those four of the five books that he wrote. The Roman emperor, Domitian, as John is getting older in his years, and this emperor takes charge. He lifts himself up. Domitian wanted to be thought of as God. He actually had a temple built for himself in Ephesus and demanded that the people would worship him and bring sacrifices to him. And so John, that son of thunder, had some backbone in him, although he was the beloved, he still had some of that, you're not going to tell me what to do in him. And the Spirit of God would cause John to stand up and to continue to proclaim the gospel in the face of this Roman emperor, Domitian, who wanted people to bow. And we think back to like Daniel, right? When Daniel had to bow before the king and refused to do that and continued to pray. The same thing happened to John. And so John, after he refuses to bow down and worship this emperor, he gets exiled, as anyone who would resist Domitian was exiled, to this Isle of Patmos. The Isle of Patmos. Now, the Isle of Patmos is not a very big island, but all of the derelicts, all of those who were troublemakers, they were all sent here. So John is hanging out with some pretty rough people on this island of Patmos. And the island is 13 miles long, about 7 miles long, 6 miles wide. So not a really big place. But on this island, and if you were to go to this island today, the Isle of Patmos, it's owned by Greece, and they have, it's actually a beautiful island with ports and all of that. But they have a place to go, and there's a cave there where potentially, supposedly, John wrote this book of Revelation as he felt the Lord gave that to him. So that's a little background of what happened here. And so I hope you have your Bibles open to the book of Revelation chapter 2. And we're going to, I hope, get through. I want to look at all seven churches today. And I know as I get closer to the end, the information that I'm wanting to give you is going to be less and less. But let's grab what we can. Revelation 1, 1 through 3, John starts the book with the revelation of Jesus Christ. It's important that we get the context of what is being written to us. It's the revelation of Jesus Christ. Who is being revealed here? Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants. That's you and I. We're servants of the Most High God. I hope that's what you look at yourself as, a servant of God. What must soon take place? He made it known by sending his angel to his servant John. So there's this angel that is giving some kind of revelation to John, who testifies or witnesses to everything he saw, that is the Word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. That word testimony is evidence, record, or a record given. It's a legal term that John literally is writing down with incredible accuracy what this angel had been speaking to him and the Holy Spirit involved in this process. He says in verse 3, "Blessed is the one who reads the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it and take to heart." So we have reading it, we have hearing it, and now we have taking it to heart. That means to know that you have heard it, and you know that you've heard it when you have taken it to heart. Listen, we hear, some of you come here week after week, and you hear a preacher preach from this pulpit lots of things. But that doesn't mean anything until you take it to heart. Otherwise, it's just words spoken. It goes in one ear and out the other. So every time we come to hear the Word of God, our posture ought to be, God, you speak to me today in a way that's going to change me. I want to take in the Word of God. He says that you not only hear it, but you take it to heart, what is written in it, because the time is near. Now, I would say to us this morning, if the time was near when these things would begin to happen with John the Revelator on the Isle of Patmos, how much nearer are we today? Can I get an amen to that? Jesus Christ can't be too far away. So in first chapter, the 9th verse, we hear John say, "I, John, your brother and companion in the suffering and kingdom and patient endurance that are ours in Jesus, was on the Isle of Patmos because of the Word of God and the testimony of Jesus." I underlined several things in my text, and maybe you would underline them in yours as well. First of all, John says, the companion in suffering. Have you suffered for Jesus lately? Do you know that suffering is part of being a Christian? The gospel that says come to Jesus and everything will be rosy is not the true gospel. The word witness simply means to be a martyr, willing to be a martyr. I've hammered this over the last year because I don't think the American church, the Western church, understands what it really means to be a follower of Jesus Christ. We got this idea of going to church, listening to a message, and maybe doing some kind of Bible reading during the week, and we sing some songs, we worship, whatever. But really, following Jesus Christ is allowing the Holy Spirit to lead you wherever He may want you to go and say whatever He may want you to say. And there may be times that you're going to be persecuted for what He asked you to do. Do we have that understanding of Christianity? John says, I'm a companion in His sufferings and in His kingdom and patient endurance. Listen, we are in a day where obviously there's going to need to be a lot of patient endurance happening in the body of Christ. Patient and enduring. Patient and enduring. Patient and enduring. But John says, I'm there because of the Word of God and the testimony of Jesus. John was willing, in the face of the strongest armies of his day, the Roman government, he was willing to stand firm in front of this Roman emperor and say, I will not bow to you. You are not God. And he probably could have been killed. But by the grace of God, he was sent to the Isle of Patmos. And because of that, today we have the book of Revelation in front of us. Why was John on the island? Because of the Word of God. It was his love for the written Word of God and the personification of that Word in the person of Jesus Christ that banished him to the island. John was an overcomer. John was an overcomer, and I hope by the end of this we have lots of overcomers in this room. He was not about to bow or worship any human being. What I really want us to catch today is that there is coming a time when you and I may have to make a decision who you are going to serve, whether you're going to serve God or man. And by the way, have you noticed that this pandemic has already started that process for us a little bit? He that has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit is doing in the world today. It's setting us up. It's setting us up. It's setting us up. And so there's going to come a time when the believers are going to say, you crossed the line, you've gone too far, not doing it. And it's going to cost us something. I said it's going to cost us something. We're going to be companions in the sufferings of Jesus Christ. That decision is going to cost us, whether it be our own life, whatever it might cost us. But those who overcome, Jesus has promised many blessings in eternity. And we're going to look at them today. But I want to look quickly at the seven churches to see what they were lacking. They were lacking. And God wants us to be thoroughly furnished, right? Lacking nothing, the Scripture says. That's what He wants us to be. But many of us, including myself, there are areas of life where we're lacking some things. And the Holy Spirit is not a spirit of condemnation, but a spirit of addressing things in our heart. He does it out of love because He wants you to be thoroughly furnished. He wants you to be perfect, lacking nothing. And so He's going to do that to some of our hearts today. And each one of them, each one had something in these churches that they were doing right, but they also had some things that they were doing wrong that the Holy Spirit's pointing out. So chapter 2, verse 4, the church of Ephesus. And I'm going to kind of blitz through this today, so buckle your seatbelts and let's try to grab what we can from this. Chapter 2, verse 4. You have forsaken your first love. Exactly. The church of Ephesus had forsaken their first love. Thank you. The church itself was pretty legit, but in their maturity of service and their recognition of those who were and were not, they became cold in their love for the Lord. The prophet Isaiah would say it like this: you honor me with your lips, but your heart is far from me. So they had this thing that they were doing when, maybe when people would come by and they would see your car parked in the parking lot. Oh, there's so-and-so. They go to that church. They're Christians, and they got this label over their heart. But is it more than just church attendance? Is it just more than what you speak from your lips? Is your life living out this heartfelt love? Let me just say it this way. Are you really in love with Jesus? don't jump on that with an amen too soon. Are you really, when you wake up in the morning, is Jesus a heartthrob for you? Are you so caught up in life? Are you so caught up, even in our daily devotional time, that we feel good about ourselves because we did a devotion, but we're really not falling in love with Jesus, we're falling in love with our ability to devote. Is anybody catching that this morning? Do we really love Jesus, or are we really in loving our ability to worship? I sing really good, and I felt a little goosebump on my back of my neck this morning, so God was there. Does that have anything to do with it when we're following Jesus? So the Spirit of God says to this church, you need to return to your first love. What a great place for us to start today. Return to our Father, would you help us as a church to fall back in love with the person of Jesus Christ? Father, would you help me to fall back in love with Jesus Christ? The problem with this church is, hear this morning, they were so busy doing the right thing that they stopped loving the right one. Maybe there's a bunch of us here today doing the right thing, but we've stopped loving the right one. Does that not hit your heart this morning? God, we've been doing a lot of right things, but we've lost our love for the right one. And this can be the downfall of the best of Christians, by the way. Doing the right thing becomes very mechanical and very carnal even. We start to adopt a self-righteous attitude. The process, it's natural for us, for our humanity to become self-righteous. We list all the things. I've served on boards. I've taught Sunday school. We go down the list, and if we're not careful, that can be the thing we're holding on to instead of the hand of Jesus. It's a scary slope. It's an easy slope for any of us to do. We end up with the attitude, look what I did, rather than look who I have become. I have become like Jesus. If what we did doesn't make us more like Jesus, it is a filthy rag, the scripture would say. Your self-righteousness is a filthy rag, means nothing to him. The second church. Well, let's finish this one. 2:7. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give the right to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. Eat from the tree of life. Jesus will be the life and the light of the city. And you and I, what I've noticed here is the thing that they overcome, maybe the thing that they're fearful of, the thing that they're wrestling with, the Lord is the supplier of that. He's the one that comes and he gives us what we're lacking, he gives us what we need. And you'll see that over and over again in these. But which is in the paradise of God. Can you imagine people being in Jesus' presence for eternity? Can anybody grab that? Being in Jesus' presence for all eternity? There are times in our prayer time, our personal devotions, wherever, where God's presence shows up. Isn't it awesome when his presence shows up? Yeah? I mean, you just don't want to leave those times, right? Imagine we'll be in God's presence in the paradise of God for all of eternity. This is not some pie in the sky. This is not hope so. This is God saying to us, if you're an overcomer, it'll happen. He'll give you what you need to sustain you. And Jesus is to be our sustainer right now. Isn't that true? Jesus said, if you eat my flesh and drink my blood, that sounds kind of crazy if we don't know the context of that. But he's saying, me, if you're not partaking of me, The second church, the church of Smyrna, chapter 2, verse 10, do not be afraid of what you're about to suffer. So Holy Spirit brings his words to Smyrna by saying, I am the first and the last, the one who died and came to life again. Jesus' admonition is, don't be afraid to suffer. Boy, I wish I could ask that question and get a legit answer from all of us today, including myself. Are you afraid to suffer for the cause of Christ? Paint whatever scenario you want. If someone was to come in here today with a machine gun and point it to all of our heads and say, hey, you either deny Christ or I'm going to shoot you. Anyone who doesn't want to get killed, you leave right now. If you're going to follow Jesus Christ, you're going to stay in this room, I want you to know you're going to be killed. How many of us would run out that door? Are we afraid to suffer for the cause of Christ? I don't know if any of us really know the answer to that until something like that happens in our life. But the church in Smyrna, they were being persecuted. And the admonition from the Lord is, don't be afraid to suffer. Why? Because Jesus did. He died and he rose again. He lives forevermore. What he's saying to the church is, listen, they may be able to kill your body, but they'll never kill your spirit. That this life is just temporary. It's here today and gone tomorrow. It's like a blade of grass. It's like a flower. It's like the steam that's here and then gone. This life is only short. You say, well, wait a minute, you know, I've lived 90 years. Yeah, and you look in the mirror and you tell me, when you look in the mirror, you say, where did the years go, right? Because time is going by quickly for all of us. I don't care how old you are. The word Smyrna comes from the word myrrh, which was used for either a fragrance or a medicinal purpose. And we can assume these people were used to a pleasant lifestyle, a fragrance and healing people with the things that they had in Smyrna. But verse 9 says that they were being afflicted, which is just the opposite. There's tribulation. That word afflicted means tribulation or pressure or persecuted. And the writer says that they were poor but rich. If I had to choose today whether to be poor in the natural and rich in the spirit, or rich in this world and poor in my spirit. And by poor in the spirit, I'm not meaning the beatitude poor. Having a lack of any sense of God's presence in my life, I would choose by far being poor in this world and being rich in the things of God. Richness of this world has nothing to offer anyone. You look at those who have been rich and famous and have all that the world has to offer, and you ask, if you got alone with them personally, if you haven't heard it boldly on Facebook or some kind of Instagram or whatever, they would tell you over and over and over again, I have everything I want and I'm still miserable. But you ask the little old widow who doesn't have maybe a couple of dimes to rub together, that spends time with Jesus every day, and you ask her how, if you had to choose between the two, and she would say this, I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather have Jesus than wealth untold. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world could ever afford. Yeah, that's what she would say. Smyrna was going through some suffering. It was safe to say that because of their faith, they probably lost their businesses. It was safe to say that because of their faith, maybe they weren't even allowed to shop in certain stores. Do you know that's going to happen again in this world that we live in? You call yourself a follower of Jesus Christ and you're not taking a mark of the beast, you won't be able to buy and sell. Have you heard all the news that's going out there? You know, Satan swirling it, the mark of the beast, all of that stuff, the numbering, the blah, 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 blah. The enemy's trying to stir it up, trying to cause us to be fearful. Listen, Jesus has always been your provider and he will always be your provider. You read through the book of Revelation, and he talks about in that day when it seems like they don't have anything, God will come and he will sustain his people. Those employed by ungodly men perhaps would lose their job, but the Spirit says they're rich. The Holy Spirit was trying to get them to see that anything man can do to them is not the end. The gospel writer could say to us, why do you worry about what you will eat or what you will wear? Does not your heavenly Father care about the birds of the air and the flowers of the field? And are not you more valuable than they? If he cares about a little bird and the flower in the field, how much more he cares about you, people? So they were going to be cared for no matter what. And to the persecution, they were told not to fear. Remember how we opened up this series this morning? I am the first and the last. I was dead, but I'm alive. You know, what can any human being threaten you with? You're going to threaten me with death? You're going to threaten me with death? Okay, I get it. On a human level, there's a little bit of anxiousness there. But ultimately, I'm going to be with Jesus. This is a winning situation. There's nothing to lose here. Paul said to be absent from this old body is to be present with the Lord. Listen, we go into our devotions every day hoping to meet Jesus. You kill this body, I get to be with him every day for eternity. Woo! Would somebody get excited in this place? This church was so busy trying to survive this life, and they had taken their eyes off the eternity and the one who was dead and is alive. So the Spirit would say to them in verse 11, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. He who overcomes what? He overcomes fear. He who overcomes persecution. He who overcomes suffering. He who overcomes suffering will not be hurt at all by the second death. So they're going to hurt you now. But the second death, when God is going to separate the sheep from the goats, the second death is for the unbeliever. The second death is the time when they get thrown into the lake of fire, where the worm dieth not. They'll spend eternity in agony and pain and torture because they turn their back on the Lord. And he's saying, listen, if you're an overcomer, you don't have to worry when that day comes. You're not going to have to suffer that. You're going to get to enjoy the eternity of heaven with Jesus Christ. So he's trying to get them to understand this perspective. Many of you, I think I'm going to just end here because it's already getting late and there's so much more I want to say. Maybe I should just make a series out of this. Many of you have seen me use the eternity rope that I use here. I found this from Francis Chan years ago, and it's a long gold rope. It's actually in this side room. Carl, can you see if you can find that? It's whirled up on behind the curtain here in this room. Thank you. And it's got a section on it that represents our life, and then it has a little, like 1-inch section on it that represents our retirement, and so we live our whole life. Oh, that's awesome. Throw it right up here. Thank you. So here it is. We usually throw this part off stage so you can't see it. So you just know it goes on forever, right? And you don't know where the end is because eternity has no end. But we live this part of our life and we're just doing whatever we can because we hope that someday we can sit and retire on our rocking chair on our front porch and watch the birds at the bird feeder and do our word puzzles and drool over ourselves and whatever else we're going to do. And so we get all excited about this so we can finally stop and just chill for a little bit. And it's just kind of warped. But the reality is this is very short when it's compared to eternity. And I often say, I use this at funerals actually, and I say, you know, you've prepared for this life, maybe well, maybe not so well, but eternity is a long, long, long. Eternity is very long. Eternity is long. It's a long time. And it goes on. And we're so focused on living a red life for a green end. But eternity keeps going on. Stop looking at the end. There is no end. It just keeps going. And can we just say to ourselves, church, there's more to life than the red zone. And there's certainly, they call these the golden years, that little green spot, the golden years. You talk to the saints who have a few aches and pains, they'll say there's nothing golden about it. Yeah. But the songwriter said, some golden day break. This is the real golden year. Jesus will come. Some golden day break. Battles all won. Some of you know this song. We'll shout the victory. Break through the blue. Some golden day break for me, for you, if you're an overcomer. That sounded so good, I need to sing it again. Some golden day break, Jesus will come. If you know it, sing it with me. Some golden day break, battles all won. Oh, we'll shout the victory when we break through the blue. Some golden day break for me, for you. As we close today, I wonder if there's somebody here that you can't honestly say you have eternity in mind as you're living your life. In fact, maybe you're here today and you can't honestly say that you have a real passionate, on fire love for Jesus, period. But you'd like to start that journey. Listen, at the transition here, the transition here from green to gold, there's going to be, as clear cut as that line is, there's going to be a day when every human being is going to stand before a judge. This represents judgment day. You're going to stand before God. And I believe there's one question that's going to be asked. What did you do with my son, Jesus Christ? Well, I didn't really give a flip about your son, Jesus Christ. I wanted nothing to do with Jesus Christ. I'm sorry to hear that, he'll say. My heart is broken. But out of his justness, there will come a punishing day for all who turn their back on Jesus Christ. And we will hear these words. I hope we don't hear them. But many will hear these words. Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. I never knew you. On that day, I want to be an overcomer. And when he asks me, Joe, what did you do with... What did you do with my son, Jesus? I want to say, Father, I loved your son. I'm grateful that he went to a cross for me, and then he took my sin. I'm grateful for Jesus' blood that was shed for my wicked heart, and he washed this old preacher's kid. I could stand in His righteousness, that I could stand complete in Him, that I could hear His voice, that I had an ear to hear what the Spirit was saying, and I followed the leading of the Lord. God, I feel like I've done what You've wanted me to do my life. I hope that we're all able to say that. We stand before Jesus, but maybe you're here today and you can't say that. But you'd like to start that journey with every head bowed and every eye closed here this morning. If you've never asked Jesus Christ to come into your heart, you've never asked Jesus Christ to forgive you of your sin, the bearer of bad news is today, when you get to that point, He's going to turn His back on you. But you have a way of escape today. You have an option. You can choose Jesus today so that He'll choose you for eternity. The Bible is so clear. All who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. With the heart man believes, and with the mouth we confess. We believe in our heart. We believe what? We believe that Jesus is who He says He was, that He is the Son of God, that He did come to this earth. He was born of a virgin, and He lived for 30 some odd years, and He died on a cross for one purpose, and that is to forgive every human being who would call upon His name of their sin, so that we could spend an eternity with Him. God's not an angry God up there trying to see how many people He can send to hell. He sent His Son so that He could redeem as many as possible. And the Scripture's clear. All who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you're here today and you've never asked Jesus Christ to forgive your sin, today's your day. This room is filled with people who have come to that juncture in their life and they've made the decision to follow Jesus. Maybe there's several of you here today and you just slip a hand up and say, Pastor, that's me. I need to make a conscious decision today to be a lover of Jesus. Are you here? And you'd slip your hand up. We're not going to embarrass you. We just want you to start the journey with Jesus so that you can end the journey with Jesus. Is there anyone here today you've never asked Jesus Christ to come into your heart? Maybe you're having a hard time raising your hand. In your heart right now, you could pray this prayer. Father, let's pray this prayer together. Would you repeat after me, church? Father, I recognize that I am a sinner and I need a Savior. And it's Jesus. I confess my sin to You today. I confess that I'm a sinner. And I need a Savior. Would You come into my heart today? Would You change my heart? I believe that You died. I believe that You rose again. I believe that You're seated at the right hand of the Father. And that even now You're praying for me to make this decision. I love You, Jesus. And I need You in my heart. Amen. I want to say to you, there's nothing magical about that prayer. It's not the words of your lips, it's the posture of your heart. And if you meant that when you said that today and you've never asked Jesus Christ to come into your heart, it's not a prayer that you repeated after me. It's what you felt in your heart that you need Jesus Christ. There's no other way. There's no other way to get to eternity. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father. No one gets into eternity in heaven without Jesus. Don't try to be good enough. You can't. I said, don't try to be good enough. You can't. We need Jesus. We need Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, Debbie and I will be leaving sometime on Thursday or Friday to get away for this month. And we want to say to the congregation, thank you for the leadership, more importantly, for allowing us the time to be away. The bylaws of Christian life has it set up where every 5 to 7 years they require the pastor to be away on a 3-month sabbatical. Due to COVID and all that, we felt like 3 months was too much at this point. So we're going to do a month of our sabbatical, and hopefully January, February, finish that up. I know from my perspective, it's kind of awkward because some of you may be looking at this like, wow, pastor gets a long vacation. I can assure you it's not a vacation, it's a rejuvenation that's needed for us. Especially during the COVID, I think what I've noticed is that we've worked so hard through this season trying to navigate everything that I became very weary. And about halfway through the prayer service this morning, maybe it was the worship service, I'm not sure, I felt like God turned the dial because I came here today weary. And as I was standing, I noticeably felt it. So he gives strength to the weary. Amen? Amen. But Debbie and I would covet your prayers. Thank you for all of you who get it and understand that we need this. And we appreciate you. We love you. We want to affirm to you again. Many through this journey have said, so are you leaving us? And one more time. Maybe I haven't said it enough. No, we're not leaving, okay? Unfortunately, you're stuck with us. We love where we're at, and this is an exciting season for us to be part of this church. Listen, we have sown for 19 years here. Why would I leave now when God says rapid expansion? I want to enjoy the harvest. That's like a farmer planting his field and then walking away from it when it's time to get the corn, you know? So we want to be here for that. And so as we make these changes in the future, just be as flexible as we can as a church to do what we want us to do. Missionaries, why don't you guys head to your table so you can greet them when they're out there. And those of you that are here today that have registered for our VIP lunch, you can meet Debbie and I down front here, and we'll make sure we get to that place. So Father, we thank you. Thank you for the Holy Spirit. We thank you for the Word of God. As a church, we want to be an overcoming church. We don't want to be a dead, lifeless, fearful church, curled up in a ball and afraid of the culture, afraid of what's going on, afraid of suffering, afraid of being persecuted. Father, we want to eat intimidation for lunch. I just heard a young man say that. Doug Mastriano's boy, Josiah, said that the other day. He said, I eat intimidation for lunch or for breakfast, whatever it was. So, Lord, help us to be a church like that, that nothing of this world intimidates us because we are standing firm on the rock, the foundation of Jesus Christ. And we know where our future lies. So may the Lord bless you, keep you. May he be gracious to you, make his face to shine upon you, and give you peace. Amen. We love you.
Amen. Speaking from the clouds.